Hello and welcome to another episode of the CollabTalk Podcast, where we discuss the convergence of technology, business productivity, and collaboration culture. My guest today is Bryan Farris, founder, president, and CEO of Goldfish Code. Welcome, Bryan.
Thank you very much. Glad to be here.
What we're talking about, this is one of those things I've been, the subject matter that I've been passionate about, really going back into the late 90s when I had my own startup. We built our own chat module within our solution. We started looking at some simple gamification tools to see if people were really in there, if they were awake and using the solution, kind of a reward mechanism with leaderboards and a few simple things. But we're talking today about exploring the impact of motivation-driven design on user engagement. It's a great topic. So, Bryan, why don't you introduce yourself more fully and what your company does?
Sure, absolutely. So I'm Bryan Farris. I'm a lifelong entrepreneur, a global traveler, and a ice hockey player and a strategist. I formed Goldfish Code, which is a strategy-first technology solutions provider. And we're really focused on aligning on our clients' strategy, understanding what they're really trying to accomplish, and then designing solutions that are going to lead to that in a way that makes sense within the context of their business restrictions and opportunities that are on the table. And a huge part of that is what we're talking about today, this concept of motivation-driven design. So often in any technology solution development, people overlook the human in the loop, if you will, who's the end user, and what will actually motivate them to do the specific actions we need them to take to hit the business metrics that we're trying to drive. And we've found that it makes a huge difference when you take that motivation consideration and make it front of mind in your product planning. And so that's the unique approach that we take. And if you like our conversation today and would appreciate a free consultation with me, head over to goldfishcode.com and reach out.
Awesome. Well, I'd say before we get started, two comments as the beginning of your bio statement. One, you called it ice hockey, and I'm always chastised by my Canadian friends. They're like, it's just hockey. I'm like, no, you're discounting the world of field hockey, and indoor hockey. But I have to ask though. So based on that, where are you from originally?
I'm actually born and raised in California.
I'm in NorCal.
Kind of unusual to have hockey from over there, but it's bigger than you think.
It's funny because I hear from my friends a lot about that. I unfortunately was working when the San Jose Sharks started up, and so it was never really a thing in my youth. Mine was very much I grew up as a San Francisco 49ers and Oakland A's fan, so I'm very still nice. Angry about the Raiders leaving the first time they left. So that's great. Well, why don't we jump in and talk about it? I'm interested in how you position this motivation-driven design. So that's a big part of your company's pitch. So what is that and why is that becoming so important for organizations?
So the reason that that's becoming so important is because so many technology solutions providers are really focused on just building to spec and not really diving deep into the psychology of the users. And so when people think of design for software, they think of two concepts, UX and UI. And UX stands for user experience. There's whole philosophies of thought around making UX more simple, more intuitive, and easy to use, and making it so that when someone lands on a new product for the first time, they're not lost. They automatically kind of grasp it and get what they can and can't do, and how to manipulate the functions of the product. And then UI is all focused on the user interface. And like fashion, it kind of evolves over time and changes what looks modern and what looks, new right now. And everyone, adapts and keeps up with that user interface so that whatever you build is beautiful looking. But the insight that I had was really that just because something is easy to use and looks beautiful doesn't mean that anyone really cares at all. And you see this time and again with companies that are pumping out a product that doesn't really solve a core need for a user, and it gets kind of lost. Or maybe it does solve a core need, but it's not a user's immediate need and the user doesn't quite see it. And so they don't really go through the motions that are necessary for them to get onboarded and, make that tool part of their daily habit or whatever, it's necessary to use it for. And so that's where the concept of user motivation comes in. And what I'm trying to kind of teach the world and preach is that really design should not just be UX and UI. It should be UM, UX, and UI. So you have to look at the user's motivation. People already kind of naturally understand this because in marketing, we do it to some extent where we talk about the different personas of the customer, and you have these different customer personas and what are their buying criteria going to be, and how does our marketing messaging need to be different for persona that's more analytical versus somebody that's more emotionally based. And so the marketing world has kind of grasped this, but when it comes to product implementation, no one's thinking about it. So by the time you marketing does all of their stuff and they get the personas aligned and they find a way to send a message to somebody to buy the product or sign up or whatever it is, once they're in, we sort of stop appealing to the things that will motivate those users to continue on with the process, onboard into the product, and use it every day. And unfortunately, a lot of this motivation stuff became a thing in the industry through the form of what's called gamification. And so that had this huge rise because everyone saw the potential of what gamification could do. And the whole push for gamification, I think it resonated with the broader community because people felt that missing piece of UM and they thought maybe gamification is the answer. And in my opinion, it's part of the answer. Gamification is like a subset of motivation driven design. It's something that it appeals to people that really care about points and leaderboards and that are more competitive like that, but not everyone is like that. So that's where gamification kind of oversold its promise because it made it kind of feel like, well, that'll solve motivation for all users. And it did have a big boost and it is very effective in certain solutions, but in others it isn't. And so people struggled with it. And I feel like it's kind of become a little less popular. And what I'm trying to show the world is that, there is a whole other side of intrinsic and extrinsic motivators that we can look at for different types of people to keep them involved. And it's all about aligning those with what we actually want them to do. So a lot of these other efforts kind of just aligned with something that we thought the user might care about. But really, at the end of the day, we're designing products for the businesses that operate them to make a profit. And so there's, a series of things that you want users to do and behaviors that you want them to make as part of their habit, that's what we're trying to motivate towards. And so motivation-driven design is really a strategic analytical framework to help prioritize features and subtly nudge users to do more of the things that the business needs them to do.
It seems like it would really be a huge topic for like an education sector, where it's again, I think you're right. A lot of gamification and people think of it just because those kind of obvious self-serve, self-driving leaderboards, and for the people that, sales organizations love it. A lot of different organization types, appreciate having that stuff. Who submitted the most tickets, who completed the most tickets. Yeah. So from an operations standpoint, we build out these and gamify some of those things. We call it reporting, but some of it is like, it's again, to motivate support and operations people on these repetitive tasks and be better gauge where we are and get a sense of, the performance of analysts, of support personnel, things like that. But in education, I mean, it's a tool. It isn't it most effective when it's paired with the human element, where there's like the first thing I think of too is gamification is the self-serve tools. If I go and if I'm working on my Salesforce certification, if I'm working on, I mean, HubSpot also has excellent community and gamification tools that are out there. If I'm going into any kind of, I use Duolingo, for example,
right,
and drive things around that. We think about that. But then there's the other half of that is the nurturing that comes from community management, from, managers, the things that are out there. I think, is that where part of the disconnect is coming from? Because they're not sure how to align that nurturing community management side with the tools, the technology, the automation?
Yeah. And what you're describing really hits on one of the elements of motivation-driven design, which is that the gamification piece and tracking achievements is very motivating in an extrinsic, motivating way, because you can see numeric values and you can compare yourself. And especially if you're a type of person that's motivated by competition, those kinds of things are very motivating. But it's motivating within within the parameters of a broader system. And by that, what I'm referring to is that when people recognize that their achievements in terms of points or badges in the leaderboard are an indicator of a broader purpose. And so this community engagement that you're talking about, where there's sort of some kind of bigger purpose for what you're doing, then it becomes so much more motivating. And so that's one of the critical aspects of motivation-driven design, is that so much of motivation is actually multiple elements playing off of each other. It's, the sum, 1 + 1 = 3 kind of thing. When you have two motivating elements that come together, it actually multiplies as you go. And when you think about something like Duolingo, part of it might be that you're personally motivated to learn a language, but why? Like, the real reason that you're motivated is because of this idea of connecting with other people in the world that you couldn't, connect with or understand before, and expanding your worldview. And so when you go into a product understanding that that's really your big goal, and that's that epic meaning that is going to motivate you on the long run, but it's not going to motivate you day to day. And so that little streak counter for Duolingo, is going to get you to go in today because you don't want to lose that streak, but you don't actually care about that streak. You care about this epic meaning, and it's the two of them together that help reinforce the behavior. And so, yeah, when you talk about communication or even just any kind of enterprise thing where they're trying to apply some sort of gamification internally, it's really important to set, that epic meaning. And there's other strategies as well. It's important in many ways to provide opportunities for creativity and choice. So when people have the ability to choose things or personalize things, they become a lot more attached to it. But all of these are elements that they need to balance each other in an appropriate way. Otherwise, you just sort of have a leaderboard in a vacuum, and there's not much of a emotional attachment for me to the leaderboard. And why should I care if I'm, top of the list, other than beating out other people?
I think that I can understand as a company like you with the methodology and approach to design, when you go in with a new customer, it's a greenfield environment, you can kind of start them out from the beginning. That's rarely the case. There's always something that's going. How do you implement this, add this into an existing company, existing strategy, existing products and services? How does that process work?
That's a really great question. And the answer is Well, first, I want to say it's possible to apply this to just about everything, because at the end of the day, motivation is very much a human thing. And so we become a bit more industry agnostic, because at the end of the day, our expertise is in terms of what it takes to motivate a human to use a product. So the way that we do it for an existing business is really to start with the business objectives. So what are the business metrics that we're trying to influence? What is going to define success in the first place? So, you know, it's almost a question of why does this product or it, this doesn't even have to apply to a product. It could be a process or some, you know, a get together for a company. Why does it exist? What is the business objective of it, you know, happening, and what are we trying to achieve, and how are we going to measure an incremental result? So, you know, you might say, oh, well, we want to actually just increase employee engagement in this particular initiative or this particular tool that we've been using, and we're not getting enough people using it. So we're trying to move the needle from X percent adoption to, you know, Y percent adoption. And so you get a few metrics like that are the metrics that you're really trying to influence. And then what we do is we go through a kind of a thought exercise to talk about, well, what are all the different user actions or actions that you need humans to take that will lead to the change in that business metric? You know, we need people to show up. We need people to log in every day. We need more people to be talking about this, whatever it is. There's, you know, as you go through it, you're going to identify a whole bunch of actions, from small little ones to, you know, daily habits that you want to, you know, big actions that you want someone to take. And then what we're able to do is then look at, you know, what does that user base or population look like from a persona perspective? So borrowing, you know, what we were talking about before from marketing and, you know, understanding, okay, who are these people? What do they care about? Because some people are going to be much more competitive. And that's where some of those, you know, gamification systems work really well out of the box for that subset. But then other people are going to be more of a kind of social, peer motivated person. So they'll be, you know, more excited about something if other people are excited about it, or if it provides an opportunity to interact with, you know, their coworkers in a unique way, or, you know, whatever it may be, but has some sort of social element. And so we look at, you know, for that particular business or use case, you know, how do we see their user base dividing up? And there's the great part about this entire philosophy is that you can do it at different levels of depth. So you can have this as more of a thought exercise and a consultation and talk through it, but you can actually do, you know, surveys and data gathering to really, you know, group all of the users into specific buckets. So you can kind of go really deep on this if you want to, or do more of a lighter touch consultation, but it's really about just following this kind of framework where we're focused heavily on what is the business thing that we're trying to impact, and then what actions will move the needle on that, and then who is it that, you know, we need to motivate to do that. And then we have our framework that goes through several motivation, what we call MA, it's motivation analysis. So we look at all these users and say, okay, how motivated are they in terms of different aspects of motivation, because there's series of you know, we call them white hat and black hat motivators, where you can kind of motivate someone on a more long-term way, or you can motivate them on a gotta act now way. And it's all about looking at the balance of that to trigger the actions that you want. So once we go through and kind of assess where we're at in the current moment when it comes to motivation analysis, then we go through a series of techniques that are, you know, that are things that you can take and find a similar way to apply that technique for that business in order to hit on a particular motivation vector that we feel like is weak at the current moment. And we might, you know, at that point come up with a feature or a process, or it can be anything. It could be like, if it's an enterprise thing, it could be, oh, well, so-and-so sends an email that highlights the stories of the top three people that did X and Y once a month. So that's a feature, if you will, but it's really just an action by somebody. But we come up with a series of those types of things that we believe will move the needle. And then we start implementing it and tracking the data results. And from there, you kind of learn and evolve and see what works.
In your experience, do you see, because I, as you're talking about this, I said, you know, I mean, it sounds a lot like many of the aspects of that, just much more in depth of like what I've experienced being a marketing consultant and working with clients to tightly align their marketing and sales activities. You're looking for that, you know, the sales funnel activities and specific steps to move a prospect through that decision tree till they purchase a product or solution, and making sure that the marketing activities align with each one of those phases. It's how you're better able to gauge, you know, are we doing the right things? And if we yep. change something, if we have a new campaign, how does that perform? Is it underperform, overperform, you know, what we've traditionally been doing in each of those phases? That's more of an external customer organization. I hear a lot of people talking about that aspect of understanding the motivations and driving that process versus internally to get people to, in like the collaboration technology space, to work better together, to do more together. Because I think it's a fundamental flaw in most collaboration strategies that we're so outward facing that we miss the fact that, you know, it's something I say all the time. It's kind of one of my mantras is that, you know, the more that we get people to work together, the more innovation, the more, you know, intellectual property we create, that we find out more, we learn more from when we're working internally than without. So if you have, you know, 100 people in your organization, but only 20 are, you know, actively participating in the dialogue, the collaboration, then right. we're missing out on 80% of the mind share of our company. And so how do we get people to work more closely together? So do you see, like, I'm sure you have both clients. Do you see more external versus internal? Where's that mix?
So I would say it's very kind of evenly split. There isn't a strong emphasis on one side or the other. But I would say that for, you know, B2B tools or internal tools, some of the motivation elements to motivate your own employees are very effective. Mm-hmm. Because at the end of the day, people often don't design with that in mind, because it's just the thought is, well, you're an employee, it's your job to, you know, show up and do these actions. And so it's often overlooked, especially when we're making some kind of admin dashboard or control panel for, you know, inventory management or something like that, you know, and you want to motivate a team to do like in e-commerce, if you want to motivate the warehouse team to go through and pick things, that job is all about efficiency. And you know, applying techniques like this internally can really drive efficiency, but also satisfaction with one's job, and create a greater community that's stronger. And all of those things have tangential benefits as well, beyond just the immediate business metric that we're trying to move the needle on.
I know a big mistake that's made is, you know, that they'll say, well, I mean, this is very much like Microsoft Word. Everybody knows how to use it. And so just kind of have at it. But then again, people bring with them, you know, there could be outdated, you know, way of doing things, an inefficient way of doing that. And so I just see that, you know, internal training. And again, that's, I lump that into the, you know, that community nurturing thing is just to remind people, that's one of the reasons, like using a gamification tool. Again, I'll go back to the Duolingo example. You're not just constantly learning things and moving up. It's constantly going back and dipping into the basics to remind you of that. And so you can better incorporate the new learning into the old way that, you know, the healthy habits that is trying to help you develop. I mean, that's why, you know, constantly retraining and testing that training, again, in my experience in the enterprise is, you know, helps with those things. I do a series of productivity tips I do sessions at conferences where we go through with a friend of mine, Tom Duff, and we do some presentations together occasionally where we share like 20 productivity tips. And, you know, most people sit through that and they're like, I've heard of this. That one's been around for a long time. Cause some of these tips are, you know, Microsoft Office productivity type things. And then we'll strike on something that they've never heard of. It might be a keyboard shortcut that's been there for 20 plus years, but they've never heard of it and it changes their lives. That's what happens with the ongoing, the nurturing, that they, something that maybe they weren't paying attention to, or they didn't catch, and suddenly, or they're at that point where suddenly they've heard it a dozen times before, but it falls into place with where they are with their habits, and suddenly they, you know, increase their productivity. But again, that's the, I guess the one experience or earliest experience I had with an outside vendor around this, you know, UX, UI design, was back in 2001. And so it's kind of weird sitting there working or trying to use the new version of our interface for our product, and then pausing is like, why did you click on that? What did you think was going to happen? What did you expect to see here? And they're like, do other things, like go check it. Like, how do you normally work? Like incorporate this in. And they were looking at all those patterns of behavior and ask a lot of questions. I felt like I should have been laying down on the couch while trying to use this, you know, talk about my mother a lot, but it was fascinating to look at that process and for that to see them make changes based on, you know, they thought this was the optimal place for that button, but most of us were like, nope, we expected, you know, these other steps to happen, and how much that changed and improved, you know, the product and the usability of the product, changed our working behaviors and our interaction with it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, what better way to achieve high productivity than to feel motivated? Whenever I'm feeling very motivated, that's certainly when I'm going to be the most productive being that I can be.
So what kind of challenges do you run into? I mean, companies bring you in, they go through this process. Where do you see the most pushback? Is it from leadership, product owners? Is it from end users around that? And how do you handle that?
I think one of the biggest challenges is educating people that gamification is only a small piece of the picture. A lot of people hear this and start to say, well, that sounds like gamification. And yeah, we have points and badges, and so there, a big challenge here is really that this idea of designing for motivation is not very common right now. And so you have to kind of first lead with convincing people of the value of thinking about the world in that manner. And then once people buy into that, I think that then it becomes much simpler. But there is still a natural bent for almost anyone to kind of lean back to, oh, so then we could offer a free prize, or then we could offer a badge or something like that. And I'm constantly trying to kind of help people step back and see a more, you know, diverse set of things that can help. So for example, a great example of motivation driven design is Wikipedia. You know, it beat out everything that existed before. I mean, I highly doubt in 1999 you would have guessed that Encyclopedia Britannica would ever go out of business. I mean, I'm sure they're still there, but everyone goes to Wikipedia first. Right. And it's all because of this idea of being part of something that really motivates the people to write. It's not because someone has a profile somewhere that says that they've hit all these badges or accomplishments with contributions to Wikipedia. It's not truly what motivates the contributors to the platform. And so it's a great example of what we look to achieve when we're, you know, analyzing a business and helping them think through how to apply motivation.
And how do you think some of the emerging technologies, I mean, as we were talking about before we started, I mean, AI is kind of a thing now. I don't know if you've heard about that.
A little bit.
Yeah. I mean, how do you see, you know, AI and machine learning kind of changing this space? Is it, evolving already the way that you're approaching customer engagements?
Yes, absolutely. But maybe not in the way that other people think about it. So I actually have a longer history with AI than the recent rise of things. I spent a few years at MIT's data science lab helping to build machine learning tools there, neural networks and those sorts of things, and learned a lot about how to do predictions using machine learning through all of those tools. And now with the rise of chatbot LLM technology, there's sort of been this huge idea that AI is going to take over the world. I think generative AI has created a new window into an area that AI can do really well at that has people very excited. And I think that just like a lot of buzzwords that have come up, you know, NFTs a couple of years ago, I think that the current, what people think of as AI is going to fade a little bit with time. And so I think it's important not to get too fixated on it, but to be really excited about it because there is huge potential. And what generative AI has done in my mind is it's created a new form of user interface. And so we're accustomed to, you know, we had website browsers now and we have mobile browsers now, we have mobile apps. We have grown through different, you know, interfaces. In fact, you can go back further and say, you know, the dial phone had the number pad and that was our interface. These generative AI large language models are a way to interact with information or data through chat. And, you know, you can, most of the things that companies are trying to roll out that can be done with those tools is just the same things that you can do with their, you know, website, or their mobile app, but now you can talk to somebody about it to somebody. And I think that it's really important to think about how those conversations will tie into the aspects that will motivate different users, because then you can really kind of hit on some of those nuanced phrasings that like tie into someone on a psychological level. So there's a lot of opportunity there. But I also like to caution everyone in terms of expecting Gen AI to do too much more than it's currently doing. I think we're still trying to figure out where it's valuable. I've seen it slapped on just about every product that's out there. And it's like, okay, there's incremental value in some of those places, but I'm excited because I think that we're just at the beginning, right? It's right now it's being thrown out and applied to everything. And we're going to, you know, curtail that back a bit, but then the areas that are left, it's going to go deeper and it's going to get very, very powerful and personalized. And that's where a big aspect of motivation-driven design is personalizing things, because once you've personalized to somebody, they feel attached to it. Right. It becomes theirs. And once something is yours, you care a lot more about it. It's, you know, these are my things. And so that's why, in my mind, one of the reasons why the whole badges thing from gamification worked was because you get something and now it's yours and it displays in your case or your trophy case and whatnot. But there could be more than that. When someone, you know, creates something themselves, they get to express creativity, and then they've made something and now that's theirs. And so there's a thing that a lot of interfaces will do is they'll try to make it so that you can actually rearrange the interface and make it, you know, the format that you want. And that slight personalization suddenly makes you feel a lot more emotionally attached to that product. And so I foresee those kinds of things going to be as something that's going to be necessary to succeed in the LLM space. So being able to somehow kind of customize how this chatbot talks to me is really going to make it feel like, oh, it's more of my assistant plugged into these other systems and my way of accessing their data and my personal UI. And then it'll become very sticky.
Yeah, I mean, I think like the difference between, you know, a public GPT out there. Think of ChatGPT, the public version of that. It's going and pulling global, available data versus something like Microsoft's Copilot or any enterprise solution where it's then built, it's private data, it's leveraging the external data, but it's personalized around your data, my emails, my knowledge, my store, my files, whatever I point it to. Yeah, I think what is kind of I was thinking as you were describing that, I said, it's almost what's missing is if I have it's one of the reasons why I still, love using ChatGPT. I use it for different things every day is because there's certain common questions that I go back in there. I leave those instances running. So it's already learned from all of those interactions. And I go ask it new questions, feed it new information on a regular basis. And it does it in context of what I've already asked. So it knows what I've said was good, good responses. I've had that interaction. I've said, where I've said, no, this was not the right answer. Try again. It's not providing good data. Almost needs to have like look at my role, look at the types of questions, look at the patterns of my questions of the data that I use. And when it provides answers, learn from that, know me to be able to then provide answers structured in and in the right profile that I'm asking for. So yeah, I think we're close to getting that with those tools. There just needs to be an easier way to go in a new library, in a new data set,
right,
to insert that profile history, without having to go through dozens, at least dozens of different prompts to train it to get to where, that history is in my personal version of ChatGPT.
Yeah, absolutely. And you hit on the key differentiator of an LLM is that it has the context, the background context. And what you are alluding to is something that I'm excited about. I think that the industry will eventually move to this place, but it will not be super easy because it's going to require a lot of cooperation. But what I ultimately see is that these AI LLM tools, you're going to have a personalized assistant that knows you. You already are describing that to some extent with your ChatGPT instances. But imagine that, now when I go and I Google sign in to my, United Airlines account, and that ChatGPT LLM instance that I'm talking to there is some kind of tie-in to the rest of my data throughout, in other platforms and systems, and knows how I like to speak, what I care about, and could really provide personalized information. So, that flight assistant booker could say, I checked your calendar and you have this meeting. And, I remember last time you had a red eye flight, you felt really tired. You don't want to do that. Just something that's personal, but integrated across data sources that the provider that you're actually interacting with might not know, but the LLM could, because it's been personalized to you and has access to information that United doesn't have access to, but it can take United's information with all of its information about you and create some really unique custom responses. I think that's the future, but it will be a little bit tricky to get there because everyone data is so critical for it's very, very much part of the value proposition of a lot of businesses. And so it'll be difficult to get them to share it in an appropriate way.
I know I have friends that are around this exact topic that are over in the blockchain side of things that are looking to solve that. Because if you think of it, it's not much different because look, I don't want my profile that just out there, even with my preferences out there, because think about it, that could be abused by marketers, by, nefarious countries that are stealing our children's minds right now through different tools. But anyway, in the healthcare industry, so very private information, I want to be able to interact with, doctors, my hospital system, you know, my providers, when they need it, to get access to that. But I want to be in control of that thing. So yep. people are actively trying to solve that problem over in that space. I know it's not the cool thing to talk about. Like you mentioned, you know, NFTs, you like, I was never excited about that side of the digital currency side of the blockchain. It's more the fundamental, the technology, the distributed, you know, secure, controllable, you know, by the individual,
right.
you know, of data. That aspect of the technology is fascinating to me. And so I know that the technology on the AI side, on the blockchain side, like, all needs to mature a bit more. It's going to be a few years away, but yeah, people are looking at that, solving that exact thing. So I think that's exactly the same problem as this.
Yeah, I agree. I'm very excited for this technology to mature, because I think right now there's a lot of buzz. There are a lot of attempts to use it that aren't that, you know, exciting or impressive. But there are some that are really opening new doors for completely, you know, revolutionizing the way that we do a lot of the behaviors that we do. And also, it's only getting better every single day. Right now, we as humans can still kind of tell, you used ChatGPT to write this email, didn't you? Or, yeah. you know, obviously this image was generated by AI. But I mean, come on, 5 years from now, it's going to be very, very different.
That's why I'm excited about all of the, what is it, Sonos, the video generation stuff coming up. Like, when are we going to see our first, I mean, we're going to see web shows and online. When are we going to see a full length movie that was almost entirely generated by AI? I mean, it's happening a lot faster, you know? Well, I do, final question for you, big question, but final question. So what advice would you give to designers, developers who are looking to effectively incorporate motivation-driven principles into their work? It's like, how do you advise, you know, new grads that are looking to, again, incorporate more of this into the way that they work?
Absolutely. So what I would strongly advise is thinking about everything from the business metric side, because ultimately, you know, the objective of any of this work is to improve some sort of metric and some sort of outcome, and to not get, not skip that. It's very tempting to jump straight into, you know, thinking about specific features and how to design them, but really getting oriented to your goals and objectives, especially in the near term, because usually long-term goals are pretty straightforward, you know, increase profit, but short-term goals can be driven by a unique business scenario. We need to hit a certain traction milestone. We have to get 40,000 signups by, you know, October 1st. Like, okay, this is a very tangible, specific goal. So I always like to encourage people to start with the goals and then take a step back and really think outside the box in terms of how users are motivated. And my challenge to everyone would be to assume that no one will care about points or badges or leaderboards. And some people will, and it'll help, but try to find other ways. And if you find other ways to motivate users, often the points, badges, and leaderboards become something that, you know, is not necessarily critical to your system, or you might find a way to position it in a way that is more meaningful to other people. So that's where I would start.
Excellent. Well, Bryan, really appreciate your time today. It's been fascinating. And again, maybe you can reiterate your offer for people that are interested in learning more or potentially.
Yeah, absolutely. If you felt like this was interesting and you want to talk about how to apply this concept to your particular business, go over to my website, goldfishcode.com, and fill out the form to request a consultation. We'll talk through it and see if we can help you out further.
Excellent. Of course, we'll have links out to Goldfish Code and to Bryan's social profiles out on the blog and out on YouTube, wherever you're consuming this content, you'll listening or watching, you'll be able to find those links. So Bryan, really appreciate your time and appreciate being on the show.
Thanks so much, Christian. It was a wonderful time talking with you today.
You've been listening to the Collab Talk podcast. New episodes are published weekly, and you can find us on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, iHeartRadio, and most other podcast platforms. Thanks for listening.